Good evening and welcome to the CEDIA 2017. Please welcome to the stage CEDIA Board Chairperson, Mr. Dennis Erskine.
Thank you very much for being here. We're incredibly excited about this year's show. And as you walk the floor and speak to exhibitors, and you talk with reps, manufacturers, and as you see the technological strides that this industry is making, I'm sure you'll be inspired. As you take some classes and interact with the instructors and simply reconnect with peers and colleagues you haven't seen in a while, I hope you'll come to think of the show as a grand expression of the support system that we call CEDIA. I've heard so many people, including myself, refer to this show as a family reunion. And it's true. You're surrounded by people who have faced many of the same challenges that you have, victories as well. You have common experiences. This annual gathering is a wonderful chance to pick your peers' brains, exchange ideas, to get to know old friends better, and to make new ones. Perhaps you'll even find a willing mentor among this crowd. You're surrounded by people who have switched the monitors on you. It's a trade show, come on. When those connections happen, we want to hear about them. This association, this thing we call CEDIA, is a network of members. That's how we survive, and that's how we thrive. While you're here at the show, I sincerely hope you will stop by the CEDIA booth and meet the staff and many of my colleagues on the board. I hope you'll offer input and take that opportunity to vote for the nominees of your choice for your board of CEDIA directors. And beyond that, I hope you'll get to become involved. Volunteer. Log into the community site and offer someone some advice. I hope that you will talk to our government affairs folks to learn how you can help keep tabs and an eye on your state legislators. I hope you'll take advantage of the training that we offer and invest in certification. And I hope you'll know how important you are to CEDIA. You are the standard bearers of professionalism. Your attendance here tonight and at this show proves it. You are here to learn. Even while you reconnect with your big CDF family, you represent this industry, and you do so brilliantly. You are CEDIA.
I hate technology. I actually think that's what makes us really good. I only like technology if it adds value to our lives as human beings and as families.
I love working with the clients and seeing something go from a concept to a full-blown project.
We're focusing on ways to make them comfortable in their home, ways to make them feel safe in their homes, and ways to make them be able to have fun in their homes.
I'm always trying to find ways to improve clients' lifestyles by simplifying all of the systems that they utilize and making it easier for them.
The thing that I love about this work and what excites me about this work is we get to make people's dreams come true.
They know that we will care about their space as much as they do.
You got to understand the things that are important to them, how they're going to live in their homes.
I grew up watching the Jetsons. I never dreamed that I would be doing what we're doing today.
The most rewarding thing for me has to be when I take clients through the system for the first time. Their eyes light up, they just get completely immersed in the music and the sound, and for me, that is the reason why I do what I do.
I am Jamie Briesmeister.
I'm Mark Onoveros.
I am Giles Sutton, and I am CEDIA.
We'll bring up Mr. Evans momentarily. But first, have some insights from our friends at Intel. When we think about the smart home, it's really about technology. Intel has been inside our homes for decades, so it makes perfect sense that Intel would be one of the leaders of this smart homes transformation.
Welcome to the stage, Intel GM of the Smart Home Group, Mr. Miles Kingston.
Thank you so much, and welcome to CEDIA 2017. Now, you know what I really like about that video we just watched? It's how seamless the experience is in that home. I don't know if you noticed, but there was a ton of technology in that home, and it was all working in concert together. Additionally, you had adults in the home, children in the home, all interfacing with it, controlling their smart home, primarily with just their voices. Now, what frustrates me about that exact same video is most of that technology, it exists today. And if we're honest with each other, it existed several years ago as well. But I guarantee you that is not the average experience a consumer is having today when they're bringing this new technology into their homes. Let's take my house, for example. I live and breathe this stuff. I've got about 60 devices connected to my access point, another 70 sensors connected to my hub. I'm gonna pause here and tell you at most conferences, those numbers impress people. I realize we're at CEDIA here, and you probably all have twice that much, but my point being, I've got all of this technology in my home. It doesn't actually feel very smart. It's extremely connected. Sometimes I think it's actually remote controlled, but it doesn't actually feel that smart. Now, what we believe is that for our homes to truly become smart, they need to be much more perceptive to what's going on inside and outside the home. They also need to become much more responsive and start providing better alternatives rather than just inundating us with alert after alert after alert on our phones. And lastly, they need to become more autonomous. They can learn from our daily behaviors. We can offload some of these mundane chores to our homes, and they don't even need to ask for permission. We want to see innovation in these three areas to really accelerate us from today's very connected homes to tomorrow's truly smart homes. Now, as we think about tomorrow's truly smart homes, user experience needs to be top of mind. Over the last 3 years, Intel has gone into over 1,000 homes in North America, Western Europe, China. I assure you we were invited. We're not going to show up next week at your house. The reason we did this is we wanted to see firsthand the trials and tribulations that people are having in their homes. We wanted to see what the pain points were, what friction did they have in their daily flow, so that we could understand what new technology could be brought into the home to help resolve some of these pain points. So we uncovered a couple things. One is a document about this thick that has over 150 new compelling use cases. The other thing we uncovered is that to enable most of these use cases, the home really needs to start emulating the human senses. It needs a mouth so it can speak. It needs ears so that it can hear. It needs eyes so that it can see. And most importantly, it needs a brain so that it can make sense of all the rich information being created by the other senses in the home. Now, we're ecstatic to bring all of this research, plus the 40 to 50 years of expertise we have in hardware, into our partnership with Amazon and the new Echo Show. The Echo Show has Intel inside, and what we have seen is that the introduction of voice assistants in the home has dramatically accelerated the adoption of smart home technology. It's so much easier to control your home and the hundreds of devices in your home with your voice versus dozens of applications on your phone or your tablet. Additionally, it's made this technology so much more approachable by so many people who are familiar with voice as a UI because of their phones or their cars, and now they are introducing these things into their homes. My parents have two Echo Dots in their condo, and I would never in my lifetime have expected they had a voice assistant in their house. We've worked extremely hard with Amazon to give Alexa some new capabilities. She now has a screen, and she now has a camera so that she can see. So let's go ahead and say a quick hello. I just had to unplug her ears there. Alexa, tell CEDIA hello.
Hi, everyone. It's great to be here.
Don't you wish everybody was that cordial? Alexa, tell CEDIA what's new. Oh, come on, Alexa. Alexa, tell CEDIA what is new.
You can see me inside all sorts of devices in the Intel booth or at the Smart Life Roadshow.
Well, that's just great. So that's actually a fantastic reminder. Just want everybody to know we have the Smart Life Roadshow here, the trade show. It's a 30-foot Airstream trailer. It's a little bit hard to miss. It's filled with Amazon and Intel voice-enabled technology. Please also come check out the Intel and Amazon booths. We have some great stuff to show and how Intel and Amazon are going to advance the future of smart home. Now, without further ado, I'd like to introduce our keynote speaker. He is the co-founder and CTO of Stringify. And prior to that, he was the chief futurist at Cisco, where he coined the term the Internet of Everything. He's responsible for numerous patents in IoT, connected cars, networking technology, virtual people, et cetera. And today he's going to share some fascinating insights with you on what he is terming the Internet of the Intelligent Thing. Please welcome me, or please join me in welcoming Mr. Dave Evans to the stage.
Good evening, everyone. Great to be here. That was actually a fantastic lead-in for what I'm going to cover in the next few minutes. The Internet of Things, we're very familiar with, is changing. It's changing everyone's industry, but it too is changing. It's going through an evolution. And in fact, IoT is beginning the next phase, which I call the Internet of Intelligent Things. We're moving into an entirely new set of capabilities, new phase, and new capabilities with IoT. So what's ultimately happening is that multiple trends are converging that will bring entirely new capabilities to IoT. And you saw a brief glimpse of that in the Intel demo, but the next phase of IoT will focus on adding intelligence to everyday things. So moving from a smart home to a truly intelligent home. And in the future, we will ask ourselves not whether, well, connectivity of everything will simply be an expectation, and the opportunities will be profound. Now, as I go through the next few minutes talking about IoT and the Internet of Intelligent Things, if you believe everything I tell you, I have failed. There are a number of facts and figures and projections in the next in these slides that are coming up, but it's not about the numbers per se. It's about thinking about how this space is gonna change over the coming years and how it will change your industry and your profession in a big way, and it will. Before we get into that, let's look at 2017. Now, 2017 was an active year for IoT. A lot of great products came out. And yet, we've sort of just dropped in the bucket in terms of the smart home penetration. About 7% of households in the US will have a smart home by the end of this year. And the global smart home market is about a $15 billion market by the end of this year. And the three most common types of devices, you probably imagine, because many of you install these, are smart lighting, smart video and home theater systems, and thermostats. And yet there are hundreds and hundreds of different types of devices. Now, a survey that was done just a few months ago between CEDIA and Home Advisor, this is just one data point from that survey, shows that CEDIA pros are also seeing a huge increase in interest in smart homes, about 87%. So the curve is sort of going up. Now, that's just the beginning, the significant opportunity on the horizon. If you look at a recent report by McKinsey, McKinsey believes that there's somewhere between a sort of $4 and $11 trillion global opportunity by 2025 in terms of economic value that IoT will generate. And if you sort of break that down and look at homes, homes represent about $200 to $300 billion opportunity. So, you know, there's massive, massive implications for CEDIA yet to come. Now, before we look into the future, let's look at the past. And the internet began life quite humbly. It was based on the ARPANET, which was invented in 1969 for four universities to share information amongst themselves. And 2 years from now, the internet will celebrate its 50th anniversary. So it gives you an idea of how much we've done in a pretty short amount of time. In 1969, there were four hosts, four things, if you will, connected to the internet. And by 1981, that had grown to about 200 plus hosts. And in 1981, we were adding roughly about 100 new things or hosts every 5 years. However, today, we add about 100 new things to the internet every second. So think about that. That's staggering, the amount of things that we're adding, 100 new devices every second. And there's some debate about how many things are connected or how many things will be connected. The projections vary widely, as you'd imagine. Is it 20 billion, 30 billion, 50 billion by 2020? The numbers are all over the place. In fact, we don't have consensus necessarily. If you look at the numbers over the last few years, even some of the analysts have even revised some of the projections. But if you take all of these projections and you average them out, it looks like we'll see somewhere in the 27 billion range for the number of things connected to the internet by 2020. So 3 years from now, 27 billion things connected to the internet. And to put that in perspective, I mentioned that's about 100 things per second. That is, over the course of this presentation, that's almost 400,000 new things that were previously never connected to the internet will now be connected to the internet. So that's over the course of the next hour. Billions of things are being connected, and we often get focused on the numbers, but it's not just about the numbers, it's also about the types of things that are being connected. And to me, that's the more interesting aspect of this, not just the sheer number. Yeah, the 100 things per second, that's great, that's impressive, but the types of things that are being connected is where the experience really lies. And, you know, we're connecting our cities, we're connecting our cars, autonomous vehicles, that type of thing, connected agriculture. I'll point out a couple of things on the slide which are kind of interesting. We're connecting livestock in a big way to the internet. There's a product called MooCall, and MooCall is a device that attaches to the tail of a cow, and it can tell the farmer when that cow is ready to give birth. It sends a text to the farmer to let them know that the cow is ready to give birth. There's another product called Horse Alarm, which attaches to the back of a horse and measures the orientation of the horse as well as the sweat from the horse and can tell the farmer if the mare is ready to foal or if the horse, for example, is sick. It doesn't end just with animals, also humans. There's a company called Proteus, which makes a connected pill. And as you swallow the pill connects to your smartphone to let the physician know that you've taken the pill that you're supposed to be taking. And the list goes on and on and on. Even trash cans, there's a company called Inevo that is a Finnish company that has connected trash cans. And the trash cans can tweet their how full they are, as well as the temperature of the can. So it can be a proxy for the environment and other things. But more importantly, it can help in terms of efficiency. So why does a garbage truck need to drive to different locations to empty trash cans when the trash can is perhaps 10% full? Obviously, it's inefficient. So these types of things make services much more efficient and much more productive. There's many, many other examples on this slide. And to be honest, some are gimmicky, some are really valuable. If you take something like a connected toothbrush, today a connected toothbrush might be arguably a bit gimmicky. You know, maybe it makes sure you brush your teeth, you spend a certain amount of time brushing your teeth. Okay, that's great. But with advances in technology, advances in sensors and so on, well, that same toothbrush tomorrow is giving you a dental checkup as you brush your teeth. It's checking for plaque, it's checking for cavities, and it's reducing trips to the dentist. So these things start to become much more valuable over time. And there's a simple truth with connected things, and that is if value can be gained from connecting something, it will be connected. I mean, I don't care whether it's your chair or your coffee cup or your home or your pet, it's going to be connected in the future because there's value in connecting that thing. Now, in the future, we will not ask if something is connected or not. We will ask why it is not, and we will demand that it is connected. If it's not connected, we'll look elsewhere for that thing. Things that are not connected will have a distinct disadvantage in the future because they won't be able to tap into some of this capability I'll be talking about in a few minutes. Now, the theme of this year's CEDIA is exponential, and it's very apropos. Exponential technology, exponential connections, exponential innovation, and of course, exponential opportunity. Very, very apropos because we're living in exponential times. And if you consider some of the data points, in 50 years, 95% of everything that we know as a species will be discovered in those 50 years, which is pretty significant. We're learning at a pretty exponential rate. Some of you will know Ray Kurzweil, inventor, futurist, author, and he postulates that the century we're in now will be equivalent to 20,000 years of progress at today's rate of progress. But progress doesn't stay linear, it is exponential. So we should see about 1,000 times greater progress over this century relative to the others. So we're living in exponential times. And human knowledge is exploding. Up until the 1900s, accumulation of knowledge doubled about every 100 years or so. Human knowledge now doubles about every 2 to 3 years. So if you think about that, when you go to college or your kids go to college, by the time they're in their fourth year of college, what they learned in the first two is arguably obsolete because of the rate of human knowledge change. And interestingly enough, 70% of all the information was created since the internet began. So the internet is an amazing sort of catalyst for connecting people and connecting ideas. And of course, we stand on the shoulders of giants. So the more we know, the faster we know more. So we're learning very, very fast. And this, again, is following a curve. But exponential growth is very difficult for the human brain to understand. We're not wired to understand the exponential function. There's a great speech by Albert Bartlett. He's a professor of physics at UC Colorado in Boulder. And he's done this speech around sustainability and energy and population. And he always opens up this speech with this quote, "The greatest shortcoming of the human race is our inability to understand the exponential function." And we don't. It's really hard for us to understand. And he also argues that is arguably the greatest challenge facing humanity. And I would tend to agree with him. So let's look at why that is the case. So if you look at the growth curve for any exponential function, whether it's investments, whether it's human population, technology change, what's interesting about exponential curves is that they're flat for most of the time, for about 80% of the time. So you really don't see any change because it's flat. And that's why when folks like myself or futurists say, oh, such and such is going to happen a few years from now, it's often met with skepticism because we're used to seeing sort of a linear change, not this exponential change. But notice how fast things change in the last 20%. Things sort of skyrocket out of control. Things change really fast. And exponential growth is really hard to detect. So this is about developing a skill of understanding where the hockey puck is going to end up, not where the hockey puck is, because things change very, very fast. And we'll use a couple of analogies to kind of bring this to life. So the first one I want to use is the old chessboard analogy. Some of you may have seen this, but I'll change it slightly. We'll use a single grain of rice, and we'll place it on the first square of the chessboard. And we'll do 2 on the second, 4 on the next, and you know where this is going. And this is sort of the exponential function. It's n squared, if you will. Now, by the time we get to the 64th square, that one square now has 9 million trillion grains of rice on it. That's what's on that square, not the other squares. That's about 150 billion tons of rice. And I know this because I did the math. I actually calculated how much a grain of rice weighs, and I did all the math and so on. And it turns out that on that 64th square contains 368 times the worldwide annual consumption of rice. And we start off with one square, or with one grain on one square, and we doubled it. And that gives you an idea of how fast the exponential curve grows. Now, let's do a money example to also illustrate. If you had a $100 bill today, and you had a really good investor, and that investor could get 10% return for you on your $100 bill, obviously after 1 year, you'd have $110. That's pretty basic math. And you compound it year over year. After 50 years, you end up with $10,000. So $10,000 based on your initial $100 investment. Not bad, but not great. That's probably why we should learn to save for retirement quite early, because $100 to $10,000 is not a lot after 50 years. After 100 years, that same $100 bill now grows to $1 million, 10% compounded annually. So that's not too bad. But what's interesting is if you now take it further, a little bit further, another 100 years to 200 years, that same $100 bill has now grown to $19 billion. So that pallet of money there, those 12 pallets of cash that you see, take that and multiply by 19, and you have 228 pallets of cash. That's what $100 will return for you after 200 years. And you might say, 200 years, who cares, I'll be dead. Well, you won't be. Humans are starting to live longer too. And even though the average lifespan is 80 today, that's also increasing pretty significantly. That's another presentation. We won't get into that in too much detail today, but we are going to start living a lot longer, so start investing early because you're going to need it. So $19 billion, $100 after 200 years. Now let's take the same set of capabilities and apply it to the basic building blocks of technology. So you've all heard of Moore's Law and Metcalfe's Law probably. And so let's talk about some of those things, a little bit of a twist. We'll break down technology and go through kind of the core building blocks. Let's start with compute or computing. Now, it turns out that technology shrinks 100-fold in 3D volume every decade. That's why smartphones get smaller and computers get smaller and so on. Sort of known as Moore's Law, but Moore's Law is more about the number of transistors you can put on silicon. This is also the physical size of technology. It tends to get smaller. So let's illustrate this. So if this is your original thing, let's say your computer, your phone, what have you, well, after 10 years, this is the size of this thing. That's the new size of your gadget, your device, your piece of technology. And it's 100 times smaller. But after 20 years, it's now 10,000 times smaller. And after 30 years, it's now 1 million times smaller. So you can see this is Moore's Law in action. Technology is shrinking, and the thing is much smaller, but it's typically much cheaper, typically much faster, and typically has a lot more capabilities. This is why, if you take something like this, this is the ENIAC, built in 1946. This was our first general-purpose computer. Not exactly portable, 1,800 square feet, 30 tons. Very expensive for that time, and did about 5,000 operations per second. So not exactly the zippiest of machines, but that's why something like that can now fit in something the size of this. This is a musical greeting card. But what's interesting about this musical greeting card, it is also 800 times faster than that ENIAC was. It's 1 million times less expensive, and it's about 2 million times smaller. And what's interesting is if you had gone in 1946 and said, I would like to buy the compute power of this greeting card in 1946, the shopkeeper would have said, great, that'll be $4.4 billion. And this is a $4 or $5 piece of technology that we are given as for entertainment. We read it and we throw it away. You know, $4 billion worth of technology a few decades ago. We are living in the age of disposable or throwaway computing because it's so easy. So $4.5 billion. But the implications for IoT are significant. They're huge. This is one example of a chip that came out recently. This is the Freescale Kinetis KLO2. And it's about 2 millimeters by 2 millimeters. And of significance, this chip is a 32-bit microprocessor. This is the same kind of technology we had in our laptops and PCs not that long ago. This is not some stripped-down microprocessor. This is a full-blown 32-bit microprocessor sitting on the letter L on a keyboard. And then about a year later, this chip was revised, and they came up with a KL03. And you can see it next to a thumbtack. You can see it sitting in the dimple of a golf ball. And this is, you know, full-blown computing for pennies. This is the Michigan Micromote. A mote is a Old English word for a speck of dust. That's what mote means. And this thing literally is about the size of a speck of dust, a bit smaller than a grain of sand. And this is a general purpose computer with processing, storage, communication, and so on. And this has significant implications. If you fast forward just a few years from now, we're now gonna see or start to see microprocessors that are no bigger than a red blood cell. Huge implications for the types of technology that can be around us, even in us, and it will have huge implications for what we're able to connect tomorrow. This is not decades out, this is a handful of years out. So compute is going through a massive transformation. Storage, we'll take a quick look at storage. This is a 5 megabyte, not even 5 gigabyte, but a 5 meg hard drive being shipped by IBM. When was the last time you needed 4 people to move your hard drive? Well, here's an example in 1956. And to put it in perspective, those of you that have an Apple Watch, your Apple Watch has 1,600 times more memory than this hard drive had in 1956. Now, storage costs are also plummeting. 1 megabyte of storage in 1956, about $78,000. Today, 1 megabyte is less than 0.01 cent. A 8 gig USB flash drive now costs about $7. That has more storage than the entire planet had on it just a few decades ago. So in 50 years, the cost of 1 megabyte of storage has plunged from about $70,000 to a fraction of a penny, about 10 million times less expensive. Now, if you extrapolate this trend out, this is where it gets really interesting. Extrapolate this trend out just 10 years, $1,000 will buy you 1 petabyte of storage. A petabyte is 1,000 terabytes. That's about 180 years of high definition storage. And said another way, you could record every second of your entire lifetime in 4K video and still have years of storage left. And that's at 4K video. If you chose to do DVD or MPEG-2 video, you could have set up a video camera during the Bronze Age and recorded every second of every day for the last few thousand years and still have years of storage left. And in the next few years, people will indeed record every second of their entire lives in high definition video. Whether it's devices that we wear or devices in the environment, we will record every second of our entire lives. So storage costs and capabilities. Connectivity, let's touch on that. Connectivity is everywhere, from personal area networks, the things that you wear, to local area networks, to the wireless things in your home, to wide area networks and metro area networks. And on average, 1 million new mobile broadband subscribers will be added every day up until about 2022. So connectivity is everywhere. About 90% of the globe has wireless connectivity today. Billions and billions of mobile subscribers. And we're seeing significant increases in speeds, whether it's for the devices that use Zigbee, Z-Wave, all the way up through LTE, 5G, Wi-Fi, and so on. There's a number of recent examples on the slide, things like LED lights that can transmit gigabit speeds through new Ethernet standards, all the way through new fiber standards that are sending data at terabits per second. So huge speed increases are coming. And as many of you know, 5G technology is right around the corner. We'll start to see trials 2020 and beyond. And we're expected to see about 500 million subscribers by the end of 2022. Consider what 5G gives you. 5G offers multiple gigabit connections. With a single gigabit connection, a 5G connection could give you the equivalent of 200 Netflix connections to your home, or 200 video sessions at the same time to a handset device. To put that in perspective, that's enough bandwidth to cover every square inch of every surface in a 1,500 square foot home. So that's got some really interesting implications for immersive experiences, AR, VR, things like that. And that's coming over your mobile phone. That's coming over your handheld connection. So the implications and the opportunities over the next few years are pretty profound. And keep in mind that 2 years later, that same capability will double. You'll be able to do the same thing now for a 3,000 square foot house, and the list goes on. Case in point, this is my own home speed since I got online. Because I don't have enough to do, I've been plotting my connection speeds to my home over the last couple of decades. I got online on the internet in a big way, meaning non-dial-up, in 1990. That's when I started at Cisco. And today, my network speed at home is around 200 megabits per second. That's an average increase of about 2.7 times per year, so it's following that curve. And in fact, if you look at the graph that I've included, you should recognize that exponential curve. For the bulk of that time I've been online, it hasn't changed in significance, but over the last few years, it has increased significantly. About a 500,000 times increase in my home network connection since I got online, so pretty significant. Now let's look at data. It should be no surprise that our things are creating massive amounts of data. And in fact, in 2008, we reached an interesting threshold. We generated 5 exabytes of new data. This is data that didn't exist before. But of significance, we created more new data. Information is arguable, but more new data in that 1 year than we did in the previous 5,000 years. So said a different way, in 1 year, we created more new data than we did in all of human history. That was 2008. If you fast forward to 2011, we're now generating 1.2 zettabytes of new data every year. That's equivalent to about 20 billion fully loaded 64 gig iPads. That is a lot of data. And if you fast forward a little bit more, let's say another 8 years or so, we're now generating 100 zettabytes of new data annually. So the following year, we'll do the same again, and so on and so forth. That's equivalent to about 36 billion years of high definition video created on an annual basis. We're creating lots of data. Consider photos as just one culprit. We take about 1 trillion photos every year. This year alone, we will take in 1.2 trillion photos. That equates for about 135 pictures per person on the planet. That's the average. That means not everyone's taking pictures, which means some people are taking a hell of a lot of pictures if that's the average. So, of these pictures, we're storing a lot. Almost 5 trillion photos will be stored by the end of this year. Massive amounts of photos. And video, also massive amounts of videos being recorded. This is just one example. This is just YouTube. This is sort of public. I've been tracking the progression of YouTube uploads over the last few years. And when I first started, we were at 48 hours of video uploaded every minute. We now upload about 400 hours of video uploaded every minute to YouTube. Said another way, that's about 576,000 years of video uploaded to YouTube on an annual basis. You would have to live for 7,680 lifetimes just to watch what's on YouTube as of right now. And of course, that will double again next year. So no chance. And by 2022, video will account for about 75% of all the mobile data traffic. Our phones are the major creator of video content. And we're expected to reach about 26 gig per month in terms of traffic over the next sort of 5 years. So video is the monster on the internet. We're now creating more new data every 10 minutes than we did in all of human history as of just a few years ago. So massive amounts of data. And interesting enough, we store 92% of all this data that we come across. So think about when someone sends you an email or a presentation or a photo, how often do you delete it? Well, the numbers say almost never. We have become digital pack rats. We file it away. We store 92% of all the data that we come across. And what's interesting about all of this is that all of this data is becoming fodder for machine or deep learning. All your photos, your tweets, your emails, data from sensors, from IoT devices, telematic data, and so on. And just in terms of the picture of AI, because we often mix up the terms, AI is the broader set of capabilities, and a subset of that is machine learning, and then a subset of that is deep learning. And that's sort of where we are now, is the deep learning aspects of AI. And these have significant opportunities. Let's talk about a few of them. So first of all, machines are learning to see. And I mean in a significant way. So here's a few examples. This is called deep visual semantic alignments for generating image descriptions. Long story short, basically it's taking a video or an image or video, doesn't matter, decomposing it to understand what's in that image. And it can do this because it's looking at lots of patterns of all these other trillions of images that it's got. And there's a few examples on this slide. There's a man in a black shirt playing a guitar. He is. The middle one, there's a young boy holding a baseball bat. Well, if my eyes don't deceive me, that is a toothbrush, not a baseball bat, but not bad. And then this cat, that is a funny-looking cat sitting on a couch with a remote control. But you can see it's really close. I mean, it's not that far off. If you look at the lady playing tennis, this is pretty remarkable, too. It identifies her as a woman wearing a white dress, standing with a tennis racket, and also identifies the two men wearing green behind her. So it's getting really quite good. So machines are learning to see, but what's interesting about this is they're also able to see things that we cannot see. This is something called Eulerian video magnification, and this is in work done by MIT a few years ago. And our eyes are not fast enough. We don't have a fast enough refresh rate in our eyes to be able to see subtle changes in skin tone. And if you look at the top of the graphic, you see a gentleman, he looks pretty static. But if you look at the bottom set of images, it shows his pulse changing because the camera can see this. It actually amplifies these changes in the video. So you literally can now see or visualize the human pulse. That's kind of interesting and really significant. What if this same technology were in bathroom mirrors, or you brush your teeth and you maybe get a quick checkup, blood pressure, that type of thing, or in baby monitors? So when your child is sleeping, it's keeping an eye on your child. Not simple movement, but it's the heart rate going up, it's an issue with SIDS. I mean, warning the parents that something perhaps is going on that shouldn't be going on. So being able to see things that we can't see is pretty significant. We've seen examples like this where technology can do language translation. You point your phone at a sign, let's say, and we'll translate it into the language of your choice. But taking a step further, machines can start to recognize things first, the discrete objects within that image, and then translate. So it knows that it's a car versus a plane versus a bike and so on, which sort of takes things to the next level. This is an interesting product called Photomath. You can probably want to keep this out of the hands of your kids or don't, whatever the case may be. But Photomath will let you point your phone at an equation, math, and from the very basic multiplication, addition, subtraction, and so on, to the very complex quadratic equations, calculus, trigonometry, and so on, you point your phone at it, and it will calculate the result for you. So really interesting. This is an example of something I did recently. I actually drew this image on the left. I'm not an artist, as my drawing clearly shows, and I attempted to draw a giraffe. This is a work going on with Google. This is called Google Auto Draw. You should try it, it's kind of fun. And as I drew the giraffe, it did an auto-suggest, if you will, kind of like you do on your phone when you type a message, but it did it visually, and you see at the bottom what it thinks that I'm trying to draw. So it shows me what it thinks my intent is. And the very first thing on that is a giraffe. That's actually what I was trying to draw. So pretty amazing, you know, these neural nets and deep learning and what we can do, being able to determine intent in this case. Some of these same technologies can even help you be a better cook. This is some work going on from MIT called Pick to Recipe. And you point your camera at the contents of your fridge or your cupboard, and it will tell you the recipe based on what it knows that you have. So really handy for folks like myself who are budding cooks. So very handy. And AI is also beating humans at games. And you may remember a few years ago, actually 2 years ago, not that long ago, when a deep learning machine not only taught itself how to play chess in 3 days, but it beat the grandmasters at chess. But then fast forward to this year, and we've had a number of interesting examples of AI learning how to play games. Google's AlphaGo beat the world's leading player at Go. Microsoft researchers bested Ms. Pac-Man. And then other video game examples. But what's interesting, look at the last three examples, all done in a sort of a 3 to 4 month span of one another, and done only just a few months ago. So machines are learning to beat us at games. And they may one day even entertain us. There are a number of examples coming out, although some limited because of limited data sets, but still very promising. So a couple of examples, this product called Ava is used by film directors. It composes music for film and games and so on. And it's already released its own album. So here's a machine or AI that's already released an album that you can actually download now. It's called Genesis. In the news last week, there was an AI that read all the Games of Thrones books and predicts what's going to write or what's going to happen next in the next series. It's close, but not great, because it just doesn't have enough data to feed it. So the more you feed it, the better it gets. And then Google's AI is writing poetry. Now, it's feasible that in the coming years, you may have a small box in your home that will generate movies on demand as you want them, without any actors or actresses filming them, but a small device in your home that randomly generates a video that you can then play on your device. And in fact, a decade or two from now, that same technology may be built into any common smart TV. So really interesting things that are occurring from a AI perspective. And the list goes on and on and on. There are many, many examples of how AI is doing all these amazing things. So whether it's getting into journalism or handwriting recognition or images or what have you, the list goes on and on and on. And AI, no surprise, follows that same technology curve, that exponential curve that I referred to earlier. So many of you will remember when IBM's Watson beat Ken Jennings at Jeopardy in 2011. That was only 6 years ago, pretty amazing. And at the time of that, IBM's Watson was capable of reading 65 million pages of content per second. Now, to put that in perspective, that's more content than every single person in this room will read in their lifetime. Here's a machine that did it in a second. And it's following the same curve. Watson has now seen its size go from a large room to a couple of pizza boxes in size. So it has shrunk by about 90%. And its performance has gone up by about 2,300%. And it's conceivable to think that in the coming decades, that same capability you'll be wearing on your wrist. AI, machine learning, what have you, is currently the fastest technology or fastest growing technology in the world. There are tens of thousands of patents in this space and 2,000 new patents this year alone in the AI space. But what's interesting about all of that stuff, all the stuff that I've talked about, AI, machine learning, deep learning, it's all moving to the cloud. And by 2020, in the next 3 years, it's expected that about one third of all data will live in or pass through the cloud. So we're moving from web to virtualization to cloud, which means that all of these capabilities, all the things that I've talked about, will become available to anything with a connection. This makes dumb things really, really smart. This is where we go from the Internet of Things to the Internet of Intelligent Things. And as we saw earlier today, we're already seeing the early signs. Whether it's Amazon Alexa, Siri, Google, Cortana, and so on, you know, millions of units being shipped and sold, we're starting to see some of these natural interfaces into technology where the machine, the technology adapts to us instead of us adapting to it. So we're seeing this shift. But what's interesting is that these things are used by people for people, not the things themselves. But what happens when this ability is available to the things themselves, not just humans? So I'll give you an example. This is a front door lock, or front door. Last time I checked, front door is pretty dumb, block of wood. But you add a low-cost sensor and a connection to the cloud, and now all of a sudden this same door is doing things like face recognition, voice recognition, gesture recognition, even emotion recognition, context, are you who you say you are, and so on. And a dumb device becomes a really, really smart device, not because it is inherently smart, because it's connected to all these things in the cloud, all this intelligence in the cloud. So these dumb devices become really smart devices, and when these things talk to one another, when your front door talks to your thermostat, talks to your lights, talks to your cameras, talks to your car, now systems start to become really, really smart. So the cloud is bringing supercomputing abilities to anything with a connection. So it's not just about the things themselves, yes, they're very important, but it's also the connections that matter. All right, so what? So let's talk about some big picture stuff and some of the implications. So although I've touched a little bit on smart home, I want to take a step back now and think about or talk about some of the big things that are affecting us as a species and things we need to pay some serious attention to. So first of all, there's a lot more of us, no surprise. This is the current world population as of about 3 hours ago. This is how many of us there were. And it took about 99% of human history to reach the first 1 billion people. And yet it took less than 1% of human history to reach 7 billion people. You recognize that curve. That's that exponential curve again. In the US, we have a net gain of one new person every 14 seconds. And if you think about that, by 2050, in the span of only 100 years, we will have added 7 billion new people. So a lot of people. And as I mentioned earlier, we're living a lot longer. In the 1800s, the average life expectancy was about 40 years of age because we weren't as sheltered, we didn't have diseases under control, malnutrition, things like that. So the average life expectancy was about 40 years or so. Today, the average life expectancy is about 80 years. So we've doubled our lifespan in a very short amount of time. And this is a challenge because by 2100, which is not that far off, one-fifth of the world's population will be 60 and older. That's going to be pretty challenging. And more of us are moving to cities. Roughly about 50% of the planet today lives in a city. And by 2050, in the next few decades, it's expected that number will grow to about 70%. And population growth will place significant stress on these cities. Cities are responsible for about 80% of all the pollution in the world and the majority of all the energy being used. And we're adding 50% more people to those cities. So it will place unprecedented stress on these cities. From a food perspective, about a third of all the food produced for human consumption is lost or wasted. And to give you a data point, and to be fair, this isn't quite fair because of the population difference, but it'll illustrate the point. In India, we throw away more food than the entire population of the United Kingdom consumes annually. Granted, vast differences in terms of population, but nonetheless, we throw away about a third of the food that we purchase. So think about going home and taking your paycheck and just taking a third of it and just throwing a third of your paycheck away. That's kind of what we do with food because it goes bad and gets lost and so on. Now, consider that we're not staying static in terms of population. I mentioned that. By 2050, there'll be 2.5 billion extra mouths to feed. We'll have about 11 billion plus people on the planet by about 2100. That's a 50% increase in our current population. Yet, 80% of the world's agriculture-ready land is already in use. So we better get really creative in terms of how we start to feed all these extra billions of people. And then one of our most precious resources, water. About 30% of water is lost in transit due to leaky pipes, evaporation, and so on. And if all of that wasn't dire enough and negative enough, we have some other challenges facing us. You can't pick up the paper, turn on your tablet, look at the television these days without seeing some dire proclamation about the end of the world. I think these things are solvable, but there's some big, big challenge that we need to address. And some of these challenges affect us pretty close to home, especially in California. In California, we produce about half of the fruits, vegetables, and nuts consumed in the US. And if you're a big fan of artichokes or walnuts, for example, we want to make sure that we can continue to grow those types of things in California. So this food feeds most of the US. So it's a big, big challenge. So having said all that, social challenges, should be no surprise, are about to grow on a scale we have never seen before. However, the opportunities have never been greater. And no surprise, I think IoT, the Internet of Intelligent Things, will play a major role in helping us tackle some of these challenges. And let's talk about a couple of them. So first of all, how we as humans connect is going to change quite radically. I mentioned earlier that 6% of the population will be 6 years older in the coming years. Huge implications for healthcare systems. If we don't virtualize the healthcare systems that we've got through wearables and pills that phone home to your physician and so on and so forth, they're going to collapse. I mean, it's that simple. There's just too many people. The population is growing too fast. So how we connect is going to change radically, whether it's the pills we swallow, the glasses we wear, the clothes we wear, even our pets. How we manage our cities is beginning to and will significantly change. Cities will become much more aware, much more intelligent, much more efficient and adaptive. I gave you the trash can example early on. That's just one small example of how we can make our cities much more efficient so that garbage trucks don't need to pick up garbage where there's none, saving millions of gallons of gas annually. So how we manage our cities will change in a big way. And food sensors will alert you before food goes bad, helping to reduce waste. I'll give you an example. There's a company called C2Sense who are developing sensors. These are called chem resistors or chemical resistors. As food goes bad, fruit, vegetables, meat, it gives off chemicals that can be detected, and we can analyze those chemicals to determine when food is going bad. And think about the implications of this. Imagine if you walked into a grocery store and the grocery store sent you a message on your smartphone, your connected device, and said, hey, I see you need XYZ food over here. If you buy this food over here, this meat or this vegetable, this fruit, what have you, I'll give you 50% off because it's going to go bad a day or two from now. But we know that you need it, so why not buy it? It's good for another couple of days. And by buying it, you help to reduce food loss, and we'll give you 50% off kind of thing. So we can do some really creative things by connecting all these capabilities together. Intelligent sensors will provide visibility where there's none and help to protect our water supply. Some of you may have seen on the news recently, a report came out, I think it was yesterday, where some researchers did water sampling from 159 different locations across five continents across the globe. And they found that 80%+ of that water was contaminated. Didn't matter what region or wealth demographic, 80% of the water was contaminated with microplastics and those microbeads that you have in different shampoos and toiletries and things that come from textiles and plastics. Plastics everywhere. We've seen it on the news in the fish, but we're now starting to consume it ourselves, and we don't know what the implications of that is going to be yet. So these types of sensors will help us provide visibility where there's none, which will be important not just to reduce water loss, but also, frankly, to help protect us. How we grow our food will change, too. This is just one example. This is a vineyard example, but the applications are applicable to any agriculture. So these are sensors that are planted within the vineyard. They collect data on temperature, soil conditions, and so on, and they let the vintner know when they need something. So connected food will start to tell us what it needs instead of us telling it what we think it needs. This is a work done by Penn State, and these are leaf sensors. Connected sensors that are powered by solar, and you connect the leaf sensors to leaves, and it measures the capacitance in the leaves, and it gives the plant a voice. It gives things that were silent a voice, so these plants can now tell the farmers, in this case, what it needs to reduce waste, to prevent extra pesticides, things like that. So, and agriculture is responsible for the bulk of water consumption, about 70%. Of fresh water worldwide goes to agriculture. So having said all that, I'm a big believer that IoT, the Internet of Intelligent Things, will help us address some of our more pressing challenges, whether it's aging in place, whether it's managing our cities, whether it's better food, water, livestock, and so on. It's about being able to manage things more efficiently. After all, you can't manage what you can't measure. And in closing, technology trends, I've covered a few, will drastically reshape how and where we use IoT. IoT is now moving into the second phase, moving from the Internet of Things to the Internet of Intelligent Things, where all this vast intelligence will be in the cloud that dumb things can tap into to make those dumb things really intelligent things. And the Internet of Things will make way for the Internet of Intelligent Things. And the opportunity, frankly, is profound. It's not just profound in the industries that you're in, but it's profound on a global scale. It's profound in terms of how we will go to the next level as, frankly, as a human species. So I'll leave you with a question. How will the Internet of Intelligent Things change your world and what you do? And with that, let me thank you for your time and attention, and I hope that gave you something to think about. Thank you.